Hi, my name's Joe Vaccaro Jr., driver of the Mary's Six Pack of More sponsored number 53 Speedster.
And my name is Joey Vaccaro, driver of the Mary's Six Pack and More sponsored number 53 Slingshot.
After a long day of work, working at home, or as for us, working on your race cars, there's no better place to stop by than Mary's Six Pack and More for all your adult beverage needs. Mary's Six Pack has over 3,000 different beers in stock and offers a 20% discount on mixed six packs. Mary's also has 14 different beers on tap and offers complete growler service for your fresh beer needs. Also come in on Sundays for some bench racing with thy bartender, Diane Tobias.
Once again, for all your adult beverage needs, come to Mary's Six Pack and More, 835 Easter Lanes, Reading, PA. Welcome to the 12th anniversary edition of Strapped In. And for September of 2016, we're going to have our special guest, Sportsman Hot Shoe down at the Grandview Speedway, Ryan Higgs. Home viewer line, 610-378-0426. If you get any questions for Ryan in the next hour. Results, Freedom 76 at Grandview Speedway was won by Jeff Strunk in the Heinemann 126. The Friday before the Sixer, the Freedom 38er was won by Brandon Grosso, getting his first win at Grandview in the Sportsman class, and Eddie Strato was the 305 Sprint Car winner. I'd like to make a shout-out to former guest Ryan Smith. Ryan notched his first feature win in a 410 Sprint Car at Williams Grove Speedway a couple weeks back. Action Track USA night at Linda's on Friday night. Timmy Buckwalder won both the Speedster and the 600 Micro Mains. 270 Micro winner was Ken Miller. Slingshot winner was Dylan Hoke. They had a five-race mini-series for the Action Track night at Linda's Speedway. Point champion in the Speedsters was Tim Buckwalder. The Speedster, the champ for the Slingshots was Sam Chicatano. And the 600 champion was Steve Wary. Bridgeport ran their King of the Mods show down there last Saturday, and winning the main down there was Billy Pouch Sr. It seems there's a couple rumors going around that Billy Pouch Sr. is going to hang up his driving suit and go out on the road in his mobile home and just catch races in the area. Upcoming events, weather permitting, Williams Grove will have their National Open weekend this weekend, September 30th and October 1st at the half mile up in Mechanicsburg, PA. The Lebanon Valley 50 will be a Slingshot National out of Jonestown, PA at Linda's Speedway. NASCAR weekend down at Dover, the 30th, the 1st, and the 2nd of October. And the Fall Jamboree for the Speedsters, the 600 Micros, the All-Star Slingshots, and the Junior Slingshots will be held at Trailway Speedway out near Hanover this year on November 5th and 6th. We got plenty of questions to get to Ryan. Home viewer line 610-378-0426. First question, Ryan. How many hours a week are spent in the garage with your race car?
I would say anywhere from, it's definitely from 4 to 6 hours a day. So that's Monday through Friday pretty much for us, because I really don't have too much crew help at home. So I would say probably about 4 to 6, so 20 to 30 hours a week.
Okay. Now, with that being said, do you have a regular crew? You said you're at the shop, or is it basically what you have at the shop also comes to the track with you?
That's basically it for me, because the car's housed at my dad's place, so he's obviously my number one wrench there. And my brother helps out when he can, obviously, and I got a couple guys, when they can, work permitting. But for the most part, it's just pretty much me and my dad.
Okay, after your first full season of Sportsman racing at Grandview, which I believe you said you ran 5 mile point as a regular last year, mm-hmm. how long during the season did it take you to get acclimated with the other fellow drivers that you're going to be racing against, knowing their moves or what they're going to do as the race goes on?
The entire year, and I'm still learning.
Really?
Yes, absolutely. That place is one of a kind to me. I've never, out of my 10 years of racing, I've never seen such tough competition and such, I mean, when you show up at Grandview, you got to be ready to go. There's no doubt about it.
Okay, now, when the season schedules come out for all these different tracks, do you look at the payouts for the midweek shows to make your decision if you're going to race or not, or do you just have a schedule you go by the whole length of the season?
No, I just go by with what I can do, pretty much, just being a, you know, the low budget kind of guy. Right. I have to pick and choose what I can do. But, I mean, of course, if there's more money on the line, it's going to open anybody's eyes. So, pretty much pick and choose, though, for sure.
Okay, now, we got a lot of race car drivers and teams that come in here. And, like, Brett Gilmore was in a couple months ago, and we also had Brad Arnold and some of these guys. They said that during the course of the season at Grandview for their Sportsman cars, they go, other teams actually give them their race-used tires to use, and it actually saves them a lot of money. Do you get any tires from any teams?
I do.
And are they partnering, or do you have, like, a contract out with them?
No contracts. That'd be nice. That'd be really nice. But no, it's just kind of things I know, you know, a couple people through just being around the racetrack my whole life. So it's just one of them things, you know, make a phone call, hey, do you have any tires? And some weeks, no, I don't. Or some weeks, yeah, I have a couple, you know, and...
Now, do you use, there are some teams that use tires just for qualifying, then they take them off and put them on for the feature. Are you basically doing that, or you run the tire for the whole length of the evening?
If I have them, I would love to do it that way, but just with not being able to bolt on so many new tires all the time, you're limited with stagger and stuff like that, so I kind of just have to roll with stagger is basically how I plan everything. That way, if I can run it all night, I will, but you know, different track conditions and all that other stuff.
How many compounds did a Sportsman class get to use there, Ryan?
Two.
For right rear,
two. Okay. I guess you can run a 48 and a 50.
Okay. Randy?
I know in the past you ran the 600 modifieds, and now you're running the bigger cars. What kind of transition is that from those smaller, faster cars to the bigger, heavier cars?
I was always said that it was the same. That's what I always said until mm-hmm. I actually came to Grandview and I realized that I actually picked up some bad tendencies from the little car.
Okay.
The biggest thing is just the weight. Mm-hmm. The weight of the car slowing the bigger car down. Even though you have four-wheel disc brakes, it's just the pure momentum and the weight of the race car. Mm-hmm. Just getting into the corner and wowing it down and knowing, you know, how it's going to roll and all that other stuff. It's
but
a
at
lot
Grandview,
different.
You want to keep your momentum going, don't
Absolutely.
You?
Absolutely. Yeah. But the thing which is good, where I learned with the 600, because in the 600, you need to keep that thing rolling at all times. I mean,
okay.
You can't break momentum in them or you're going to get freight trains. So.
Yeah, they always say, what, corner scrub speed is the worst thing
yes.
you can have in a small car.
Absolutely.
Now, when you ran at 5 Mile Point, Ryan, were there sail panels on those cars?
No sail panels. Nope.
Okay, was it like hitting a wall, putting a sail panel on for Grandview?
Yeah, in a way. I got to try Susquehanna at the end of the year, the Candy Bowl when they still had Sportsman's right. there. So I got to try that for the first time, and it makes a major difference. I mean, it's night and day with them things on there for sure.
Now, does it actually slow you down going into the corner, or does it actually set the wind, the air hitting it, does it actually set the right rear down and give you better bite going into the
Definitely
corner?
Gives you a lot more bite. You can feel it just squat the rear of the car down. So, I mean, more bite, obviously, you're going to gain some speed. So, but you can feel it when you throw the car into the corner. But for the most part, I think I feel more of the squatting of the car.
Well, they said
more
it
than anything.
Tightens everything up, too.
Absolutely.
You have to make the car maybe a little looser when you run them.
Yes. Definitely, you need to loosen the car up a lot, and then you take them off.
Home viewer line 610-378-0426. You said you ran the 600 modifieds. Was there any other classes that you were racing in prior to going into the Sportsman class?
Nope.
No go-karts?
No, I never ran go-karts. About my experience before that was warm-ups and a street stock. That's about it.
Now, with the 600 modifieds, did they run any asphalt speedways?
Yes. Second year or third year, we went to Mahoning. Ran Mahoning, actually. I never never even saw the place before in my life, and went there and actually got the win that night. So that was that was a pretty big night.
That was different, though. It's basically a circle.
Yes. Yeah. It is a circle.
I mean,
for sure.
Do you get lost out there?
Yeah, I was gonna say, can you actually lose your? Because a lot of guys say they get dizzy and they actually lose themselves on the racetrack because
I know they have put numbers on the walls in the turns, so you kind of know where you're at.
I can tell you, I was locked in my seat that night for sure. I mean, it was. I was in there and I really didn't see the white flag.
Oh, okay.
Okay, with all the big hubbub going on for Super Dirt Week up in Oswego this year, you have any plans on going?
I'm up in the air yet. I do have off Monday, though. So that's so I have that in my back pocket. But I'd like to, for sure. It's just how long I'm going to go, if I'm just going to go Sunday or if I can go the whole weekend. So something like that.
Okay. Now, I got to get my glasses on here. Here's my questions. While you're at the racetrack, when your division isn't out on the racetrack, do you watch the other Grandview divisions, the late models and the modifieds, while they're out there? Or are you back in the pits working on the race car?
I try to. I think that's a big part of what I was taught, is always watch the racetrack. Don't ever lose sight of the racetrack, or always try and keep an eye on it and see what it's doing. But you're so busy back there sometimes that you just don't get a chance to. But if I do, I absolutely watch.
Okay, we're going to ask you the every show question. Do you go out at intermission with a screwdriver and scratch the racetrack?
No. No, I don't go that far, but I will watch the graders go around the track for sure.
You just watch where the cars are running at, basically. That's going to tell you if you go top or bottom or whatever.
Not necessarily. I mean, yes and no, but more or less I'm looking at color of the racetrack, you know, how wet it is, color, if it's dusty, you know what I mean, if it looks like it'll take rubber, you know, any of that stuff.
Well, to you guys run, it's smooth and slick at the end of the night, so.
Yeah, that's what makes it really
tough.
Do
you actually watch the modified feature, maybe like the first 10, 12 laps or something?
Yeah, I stand on the top of the trailer and watch.
Oh, okay.
Until they start hollering over to the speaker to get in the car.
Okay.
Has there been any driver this year that stands out in your mind that's really helped you pretty good during the course of the season?
You're saying from watching or like physically helping me? And
physically helping or giving you pointers or?
I talk to a lot of people, actually. Doug Manmiller actually helped me a lot closer to the end of the year. I started talking to him, but mainly the Ryan Grimm from Sea Rock Fabrication and Steve. They did wonders for me this year, and really I give it to them to really get me going in the right direction for sure.
Well, you didn't come to Grandview blind, though. You ran the 600 there, too.
Yeah. But with the 600 there, it was a little bit different because it was just wide open all the way around the track all the time.
Yeah.
So it's a lot different where in the sportsman car, in the heat race, you're going pretty good. I mean, that's for sure. But then when feature time comes, I mean, it's night and day out there. It's heavy to absolutely nothing left out there. So learning curve.
Now, this is my daughter's question. Thank you, Jen. And she's very safety conscious. Do you use the safety devices? Do you use the Hans device? Do you have a self-containment seat? Do you have any of that stuff?
Got it all. I wear fireproof underwear. I got a two-layer suit. I got a Hans. I got a full containment seat, new helmet. Definitely. I watched why not? Yeah. You know what I mean? Why not? Spend the extra money to do it. It just makes sense.
Okay, for you fans that don't know what we're talking about, the self-containment seat, you actually go in there, if you watch NASCAR races, and the actual headrest comes around them that they have trouble vision with their peripheral vision. Do you actually get a feel of what's to the left or the right of you with that seat, Ryan?
Yes. Yes, I do. They have adjustments for that. I mean, the headrest can move up and down, so you can keep your sight lines. And with the new advancements of the head and neck devices, you can turn your head. Like when they first came out, your head was like really stuck there. So I think they would do with the tether straps and stuff like that. They made them so you can, you know, your peripheral is good.
Well, speaking of sight lines, though, when you go in the corner with the sail panels on the other cars, do they like block your view of other cars? I mean, do they kind of get in the way of your...
It definitely will obstruct your further away vision when you're trying to look ahead and stuff like that. It'll definitely block you in a little bit for sure.
Okay.
Okay, being you're sort of a tall person, and we've asked this question to a lot of people, do you like to sit down in the car and look out, or do you like to sit up in the car and look over?
I like sitting down and looking up, for sure.
So what actually do you see in the front end? A lot of these guys just say they see their shock towers, and that's it.
Yeah, but for some reason in my car, though, I sit high. I don't know if it's just the style of the chassis or what it is, but I sit pretty high in that car, so I can see. I can't quite see my tires, but I can see, you know, the shock towers. And if I move a little bit, then I can see my tires and stuff. But yeah, for the most part, I sit pretty high in that car, though.
Okay, now with that being said, and you said you were in a street stock, did you ever try sitting in a late model where they're actually on the complete left side of the car?
I've never sat in a late model. No. I mean, my grandfather, one of his last productions, him and his buddy Greg, they pretty much took a late model and turned it into a street stock. I might have sat in that, but how those guys drive them cars, it's beyond me.
Would you like to ride the two-seater in the IndyCar series at Mario Andretti when they take the two-seater out for the IndyCar? Do you think that would be something that would be cool for you to...
Yeah.
Visualizing the speed of them compared to...
Yeah, I could do it, but not for that long, because then I'd want to drive it. So,
do you have any plans of moving in anything else then, Ryan?
Of course. I would love to. That's for sure. It's hard to say, though, because of me being, you know, the underfunded guy.
Right.
You know what I mean? But, of course, you always have aspirations for that. But right now, I like what I'm doing. I mean, I enjoyed my year this year. I really did. It was one of the most fun years I've ever had.
Okay, we got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
During the Sportsman feature, have you ever realized that you made the wrong chassis setup? And if so, is there any way for you to correct that? And
yeah.
How do you, if you can?
Yes, to answer your question, a lot of times that happens. But at Grandview, you're allowed to run your panhard adjuster there. So your panhard adjuster is basically moving the rear of the car left and right. So that will help you do that. We also have like indoor or inside the brake bias, so you can change from front to rear brake. That'll also help you with the car a little bit. Where like at 5 mile point when I ran, you weren't allowed to run the panhard adjuster. So basically, if you went out there and your car wasn't very good, you were stuck. There wasn't really too much you could do. So Grandview does let you do that, which is nice. But me being the rookie there, those other guys have it down where they know, okay, I can turn this and turn that, and they're going right to the front where I'm still playing around with it and learning. So.
Thank you.
Thank you for your call. So, do you have adjusters that you can, I mean, there's classes of cars where they hit a little switch and they can set the chassis weights on different corners. Is that something you can do in a Sportsman, or you just have like a brake bias and those little things there?
I just have a panhard bar, a brake bias, and a shutoff. That's pretty much all I have. So, I don't know if we're allowed anything else. That'd be good to know, but those are the three things I have. So, I'm still learning with that. For sure. It does a lot. The panhard does a lot.
Now, I'm going to ask this, being as dumb as I am, for a Sportsman, do you actually have brakes on all four corners, or is there one corner where you don't hook the brake up for the chassis setups going into the turns?
Well, that's where I have there's built-in shutoffs right in the car that you can shut the right front off, so therefore to turn the car into the corner. But one thing I did notice with Grandview, just how the angle you're going into the corner, if you do have to jump on the brakes and you have your right front shut off, you're probably going to spin out. I mean, so I'm sure some guys are way better at it than me, but I noticed that too. I think it was Whitmore that told me that. I was talking with him one night, and he said, to learn here, he said, take that thing. He said, turn it on. It'll help you learn to get around the track better. And then once you learn how to do that, then maybe you can play around with it and see. But that's one thing I did notice. If you have to jam on the brakes with your right front off, you're going to spin out, probably.
Okay, now do you keep chassis notes every week and you write down the track situations as far as being wet or dry or rubbered up or...
Yeah, if it's way out of the ordinary, yes, I will. You know, if it's super heavy or if it takes rubber, I'll kind of write a note. I do keep notes every week. I scale the car every week. I'll keep notes on all that. But, yeah, if it stays consistent, I won't really write too much. But I'll say, yeah, it took rubber, you know, lap 5 or lap 15 or stayed heavy with a cushion all night. You know, stuff like that. Just little footnotes.
You watch the lap counter? You watch the scoreboard?
No. No. It's hard to see at Grandview.
Randy.
Yeah, your grandfather, of course, everybody knows is Jack Zeiner Senior. Mm-hmm. Junior's his son. Mm-hmm. But I mean, he started out with the figure eights, and then he got into late models and different things like that. Your dad is Chris Higgs, who was a late model driver, pretty good one. Mm-hmm. Why did you go into the modifieds and 600s? Why didn't you just follow them into the late models or full body type cars?
The street stocks got to be not what they used to be.
Okay.
They used to just be, you know, Chevy. I mean, we had Chevy Novas. That's just what mm-hmm. our family ran. We always had Novas. You can get parts from junkyards.
Used to be a hobby class.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. But now it turned into, you know, these guys have, the cages are set back. They're automatics, four coils, no leaf springs.
And they don't get much pay.
So it got out
really,
of control. Yeah. And, you know, my parents and my family, not that my family doesn't condone what I do, but they all kind of do it their own way. So it's not that I'm funded by anybody. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? My dad pretty much told me, you know, you want a race car, you go get it. I'll help you. So it came to just being that, really. And then at that time, you know, my uncle was done racing. My cousin Zane was just running, you know, asphalt modifieds at that point. My dad was done and Jackie was done. So I just stumbled upon that, really, the mm-hmm. 600, and it was just affordable for me at the time, and that's what I rolled
you
with.
You could have followed Zane into the asphalt cars, too.
I could have, yeah. But I was born on the dirt
side. Oh, okay.
Is there anything that you can, from the track time that you go out for the hot laps and the track time that you go out for your heats, can you get any kind of reading, because the track's going to be completely changed when you go out for feature time, but can you get any kind of reading, and you said you do check the track for color and moisture and stuff, just by going out in the heats and seeing how the track's starting to either slick up or take rubber or whatever. Can you actually tell from the earlier times on the racetrack for your feature time?
Yeah, I believe you can. Grandview is difficult to do that, for sure. But the Grandview does a good job with the racetrack. I mean, that's just really what it comes down to. I mean, it could get a black lane or something like that through the heat races and might get a little bit slick, but then, you know, if they cut it for the feature time for the modifieds or something like that, we could have a better track. So that's hard to say. Other racetracks was more predictable, I believe, than that, but Grandview makes it tough.
Okay, now we were talking before the show started. You had a decent season, and all of a sudden coming down for the checker on the last point race of the season, the engine just expired. Who does your engines, and do they give you a serious input on the idea of, you know, what you got to do to maintain the engine during the course of the season?
Yeah, for sure. Randy Peters does my motors. He's a family friend. He's been friends with Jack and worked for Jack for, you know, oh my God, 30. He still works there at the garage. So he's been a family friend, and he always told me if I got, you know, in a big car race, and he'd do it. And I call him all the time. I mean, I do. I adjust my own valves. I do my own motor maintenance every week. But if I see any inkling whatsoever, I'm on the phone right away saying, what do you think about this? You know, what do you think? Not really anything out of the ordinary.
Does he do the machining and you actually build the motor, construct it, or does he do the whole
thing? No, he did it all. The only thing he let me do is when I blew it up, he let me take it apart.
Oh, so you learned.
I got to learn a lot doing that. So I was. Oh, okay. I was fun. I was into that, even though it was a sad day because I was done for the year, but it was neat to learn.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now the Grandview Sportsman class, they allow the crate engines, and there's a couple guys moving to them. Do you have any aspirations of getting a crate engine, and does the availability and the cost of them make it more enticing for some of the racers now?
I think it does entice people, but I'm pretty much against the crates just because of what goes on, and it's not really so much around here. I believe it's more up north that you're spending the money for the crate, but what you have to do afterwards, it's a fine line there. I believe there's some shiesty things going on with crate motors. I fully believe that. I don't think it's down here too much, but definitely I learned that up at a 5 mile and stuff like that, that what these guys are doing and how they're doing it and getting away with it is
John Hegley used to run his crate motor. He'd run at that New Egypt and Bridgeport on the same night, and he'd just go to the gas station and put gas in it, you know, regular pump gas. And he'd go out and run that thing for years and really never take it apart much at all, just keep it tuned up.
Exactly.
And he ran that thing for 5-6 years.
Yeah, I think it would be a good deal if they could police it better. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Okay. Now, what was your decision? What made the decision to go to 5 Mile Point for your sportsman career last year? Was that availability to, or close your availability for hours from work, or how did that work that you went to 5 Mile then? For...
It ended up being a rough decision doing that. mainly because of all the laps I had at it. Just I ran a ton of laps up there with the 600, so I thought, you know, it's a good place just to go, and it's on Saturday, so that does help for work. And you got a lot of room up there, you know what I mean? I thought it was better to not feed myself right to the wolves, so to speak, at Diamond and Grandview and stuff like that. But it ended up being a lot because I was still driving a 600 at Linda's on Friday nights too, so that got to be... I got a lot of miles on 81 ripping up and down, that's for sure.
Now with the 600 modifieds, they have like a touring series. They have a weekly series. You're running with a lot of the same guys, you know, week in and week out in that class. Is that an actual class where you could actually get your driving abilities from as far as the track being slick, you know, to feather the pedal and stuff like that? Is the 600 modified class a class that, you know, somebody can, moving up the ladder, can actually count on to help their racing abilities and careers?
I believe so. Most of the tracks don't get as slick as what you're going to see in a big car. I mean, they do get slick and you're going to have to feather and wheel and stuff like that, but I think it is just because of the pure speed of the 600 mod. I mean, there's no secret. They're really fast race cars. They're fast race cars. And that is the biggest thing that I got acclimated to, as the speed was, once I got in a big car, the speed was pretty close. Whether, I mean, I don't know on an actual radar or anything like that, but just feeling from the seat, I mean, it was pretty close. But I think it is. I mean, that's why you see a lot of people. I mean, I raced against a ton of kids, quarter midget kids. When they're done, outgrew quarter midgets, and then they go into one of these, and they can afford them because they can't, you know, jump right into a 600 sprint car and stuff like that. But I think it will definitely get you going in the right direction,
for
sure.
We see the same thing, like, as I work for the, you know, Rich Tobias, which we do the slingshots, and they're sort of, actually Doug copied the 600s from what Rich did with the slingshots, and it's at a point where, you know, once these kids are out of the quarter midgets, it's like, where do we go next? And for the price of what it runs to run a 600 micro, the engine alone is pretty expensive in that one. So, you know, the move to slingshots and the move up along that way. We got one more question before we go to our picture time. Randy, we'll let your question here.
When you drive now at Grandview at the end of the night, it's the smooth, slick, slippery. You have to have throttle control. Mm-hmm. And that take a lot of training, I mean, like through your head and what different track, because it's... You have to kind of feather everything. You can't just hit the gas and go. You got like in the heat race.
Right. It's more, it's seat time. They always say you got to feel in your rear. I mean, your rear drives your foot.
Okay.
You need to have your head with your rear and your feet all together. It's something I had to learn a lot of, because when I did run 5 Mile, we were first cars on the track for the feature. So our features were heavy and we were running the car hard every lap. Where Grandview, I mean, there's
the opposite,
a ton of throttle control involved, car control. You're on top of one another racing people, and it's quick. It's just a fast racetrack. I mean, no matter what you do, anything you do there, it's just fast. Mm-hmm. Things happen in a hurry, and you have to be on point. You can't be sleeping at all.
Does the banking actually make it better for you? I mean, you can really use the banking a lot.
I prefer bank tracks. I kind of had a liking to them.
Okay.
It gives you more room, so to speak. I mean, I think flat tracks, you really actually end up having to run the car a little harder than you do, because the banking will, if you run it right, you'll get some momentum going.
But, come down off the bank.
But
yeah.
Like you're saying, with the throttle control, that's the big deal there for sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, home viewer line 610-378-0426. We're going to go to some pictures now, so see what we can discuss here. That's not exactly 2015 or 16.
That's,
there.
What, Nazareth?
That would be Nazareth Speedway, yeah.
That's a half mile.
If I had it, I'm not sure on a year either. I would say 82.
No, I remember when Jack came there and they started with the figure eight division and all that. We thought, what is this? And then once they started racing, it actually was a fun race to watch the figure eight guys out there.
Now, those were actual Novas, weren't they?
Yes. Right? Yes, they were.
Okay, now, was this a class where you could build your own chassis, or was this the class where you just added a roll cage to an existing Chevy, Ford, Pontiac, Chrysler
Well, I mean, this was going on before I was even alive, but our cars were definitely just put in roll cages for sure. They were definitely, you know, production cars at one point and then just turned into race cars. But I'm sure at some point guys started showing up with the custom cars and stuff like that. But no, these were definitely just cars out of the lot and turned into race cars.
The one guy that you race with at Grandview, Rich Jones, with the, what is it, 135, I guess it is?
Okay.
He used to race those cars like that up at Nazareth and places like that.
Oh, yeah.
And then he got retired for a while. Now he's back with the Sportsman cars.
Okay.
Okay, with that picture there, who do we actually have in the picture, Ryan?
Well, the 16 is my dad, Chris. And then the 8 is my grandfather, Jack Zeiner.
Okay. Jack always had the Elton Hildreth little thing.
The little sign on the roof.
Yeah.
Now, are any of those cars still in existence anywhere? Does your dad have it hidden away anywhere in a field or anything? Or
no, my dad's, that car got destroyed, actually, at Nazareth. I wouldn't know the year, but that car got completely rear-ended in an accident and got destroyed. My pap's car, however, about a couple of years ago, they bought it back, or they had it in his dad's garage. Right. So we brought it to my girlfriend's dad's place, and we started going over it, and me and my brother actually got to drive it down the street. He was freaking out because he didn't know if the brakes were working. I said, I'm not passing up on this opportunity, so we're going. So, but then he ended up selling it. He just didn't have the room for it anymore.
Didn't he want to, like restore it?
That's what his plan was. Oh, okay. It just didn't, you know, it just, he got the ball rolling, but it just got to be, you know, too much time and stuff like that. And he's enjoying the other side of the fence.
Does he come to Grandview and watch your race?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
Yep,
okay.
He comes, I don't know about every week, but like I was saying, he's more into the other side of the fence now. I mean, he spent so much time in the pits for all them years between.
Oh, so now he's in the stands watching.
Correct. Yeah, okay. He goes all over the place. He just is enjoying being a race fan now, mm-hmm. instead of, you know, being on the other side.
Okay, now either of them, some of your weekly help at the garage?
Oh, my dad is, for sure. My dad's my main help, for sure.
Okay. Next picture, please.
Okay.
One of the 600 mods.
Yeah, that was the first career win up at Black Rock.
Was that
how long did it take you for the first win, roughly? How many?
That was my rookie year, and that was August 11th. That was so 3/4 of the way through the season.
Oh, okay,
something like that. 3/4 of the way through.
Is that's when the Hogs still ran the racetrack?
That's correct.
Okay. Yep. Now, for any of you fans that are Black Rock is now, I believe, Outlaw Speedway. And it's
that's a long way up there.
Yeah, five.
That's pretty near Watkins Glen.
Mm-hmm. You drive right past Watkins Glen.
You go through the wine country up there.
Yeah, through the town, and you end up going a little bit in Dundee's, and then the track's right there on your right hand side. You can't miss it.
Okay, now with the 600 mods there, did you run aluminum wheels all the way around them, Ryan, or was?
Yep. Yeah, they're all aluminum. Still, I think that's still the same rule, and they've always been aluminum.
Okay, now as far as the actual 600 itself, is that a 600 motorcycle engine?
Yep, yeah, it's a 600cc. I mean, mine was a Suzuki. Back then, you had the choice from Suzuki or Honda. I was a Suzuki guy, but it is sealed. You cannot touch it. You can't, you know, put power commanders on it, or, you know, run titanium or anything like that. So that's what made it, you know, really good then. It's just set up in driver, really, because it took the motor out of the equation.
You actually had a ride, right, when you ran the 600s?
No. That just came about the last couple of years.
Oh,
actually.
Okay. This,
but that was my, I bought that car used, and then.
Oh, so when you started, you had your own car?
Correct.
Basically.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the first car I bought.
Okay, so basically what we're looking at there, without sounding pretty off the wall and goofy, that whole car there, basically, that you're standing by, Ryan, would just probably go to the end of your door for the Sportsman.
That car is exactly 10 foot.
Oh, okay.
That those 600s are from bumper to bumper they're basically 10 foot.
Okay, so if you could put that inside your driver compartment of your Sportsman, I'm assuming that in the 600 modified you had a good vision of the front end there with the...
Yeah, that one I could see out of for sure.
Okay.
For sure.
Now, they ran with it Hoosier tires all the way around?
Yeah, that back then it was still the Hoosier days.
And
I believe now he switched to American Racer, but all through when I had my own car, it was always Hoosier all the way through.
Did you get good tire wear on the 600 mods?
Yes. We got really good tire wear with the Hoosiers. The Hoosiers were, they were really good tires, actually. Now,
could you set your, could you adjust your corners on there with the coilovers, or was there?
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's how you adjust those cars. It's just, you know, turning springs and panhard bars. That's pretty much all you really had in squareness. You know what I mean? You can put the axles in crooked, stuff like that, but that's really all you had. It was just, you know, adjusting with the coils.
Does your actual type of tire set up, I mean, when you set your car up, is that different from, you know, running, say, a Hoosier to an American Racer or whatever?
Well, when he did switch to American Racer, I was still driving for Horning Racing, and they were a lot different. When I went out there, I said, man, and I came back and I said, man, these tires are different. I mean, they're actually softer than what the Hoosiers were, and they're smaller. So it definitely reacted to the car, and right off the bat, it changed your frame heights. Just bolting them tires on, if you had the same exact car and just changed the tires and bolted them on, they were already smaller, so your frame heights were already lower.
Okay.
So it definitely took a lot different.
Now, did stagger sizes mean as much to that with between the right rear and the left rear as they do in the Sportsman?
Absolutely. Yeah, and especially probably more in the 600 because you had less to adjust on. You know, I mean, it's definitely a big thing with the big cars and stuff like that. But when you only have, you know, three things to adjust on, you know, you got to get it where you can.
Okay. Next picture, please. Ooh, it's big car time.
I know Craig Whitmore was telling me when they ran the 38er, he said Grosso came with bigger doors, taller doors. Mm-hmm. Does it make, is there a rule at Grandview you can only have certain size doors? Could he run there as a weekly guy? Would he have to change his doors?
I don't know the
not
rule.
Picking on Grosso, but I'm just saying.
Yeah, I don't know the rule, actually, because I don't think I need to worry about body heights yet.
No, because he was telling me, he said, that's just like with the sail panels and whatever. Sure. It changes your car completely around, and other guys don't have that advantage.
Yeah, I would believe that for sure. I mean, that's just, you can get in anywhere you can.
Mm-hmm.
But with the taller doors, that's kind of beyond me yet. I'm not.
Oh, okay.
I'm not completely up.
Because when he's in the car, you basically see, you know, from here looking out, and right. The other guys, you see their whole.
I mean, I know Cliff is in during heat races. Cliff is measuring door heights. So.
Oh, okay.
I saw him a couple times this year. He's in there with tape measure, measuring door heights. So.
Okay. Is that the same chassis and stuff that you're running that you ran in 2016?
Yep. Oh. Yeah, this picture is actually from Grandview last year.
Okay.
Because I went to practice at Grandview, but this would be the 5 mile car, but everything's the same.
Okay. I mean, what kind of chassis do you have, Ryan?
It's a Bicknell.
Okay.
Bicknell 2012 Bicknell.
Well, now this year, did you just change the body, basically?
Yeah. Yeah, I just put a new body on it, and that's.
So the car was basically the 5 mile car with just a different body?
Yeah, everything was the same. Everything. Just
okay.
Different body, that's all.
So the Grandview style motor is okay up at 5 mile point?
Yeah. Well, yes and no. I mean, I could have done more to my motor at 5 mile. You're allowed to do a little bit more up there. You can port your heads and stuff up at 5 mile, where Grandview you're not allowed to. So I decided not to do that just because I knew I wanted to race closer.
Oh, you knew
to home.
Eventually you were going closer.
I would like to. I wanted to go closer. So I just kind of set myself up for going to different places and stuff like that. So
okay, with seeing that picture there, and we talked about this earlier, scrub speed in a small car is actually the kiss of death. But there you're tossing the car sideways. You know, you're actually turning right to go left. Does actually doing that more, did you actually get a better bite doing that, Ryan? Or can you still drive into the corner and keep the car straight and go just as fast? Does the actual sliding help you in the corners at all?
I don't think so. I mean, obviously, the straighter is faster, no matter what. But in a way, you have to, I think, especially at Grandview, just the way that this the track is shaped like a paperclip. So, and naturally, you're going to need to slide it out a little bit. But there's definitely a fine line between, you know, not sliding enough and, you know, being super tight getting in, or throwing it in too hard and then you're sitting there chasing it and not being able to do anything and just have the thing turn to the right.
It was funny though, like in the Reading days, they go in and throw the rear end around. Yeah. Now they drive it straight like an asphalt car.
Yeah. Yes, I believe straighter's faster no matter what.
Okay, we saw floors on the car.
Yep.
Are they something that come along for the ride, or is this
Well, people get mistaken. It's not floor, machine, and tool. That's, you know, Dougie Floor, and right. He's starting to get back into it again. It's actually his brother, Jim, who owns an auto body business. He's been with me since day one, actually. I went to school with this kid and just kind of grew up with him and knew he was into racing, and he's helped me from day one, that's for sure.
Okay, now we saw your dad have the 16 and you have the 16. Where did number 16 come from?
Pretty much from that, yeah.
Did he have any idea, just picked it up out of the clear blue sky?
That's actually a good question for him, actually. I don't know that. I never even asked him that, really. Maybe he just times the 8x2. That's what I always thought. So
and of course, through Jack and all, that's where the orange came from.
Correct. Yeah, the orange and black was definitely, you know, from Jack and Tom, Jack's brother.
Yeah, yeah.
For sure.
Okay, when you had your big sportsman showdown down at Grandview, and you were, I believe, the first feature for the night instead of the last feature. Do you actually like running on the modified style racetrack compared to your track when you get it?
Yes. Yeah, because I think it opens the track up more. That would be my only little bit of gripe that I would have, is just the fact where there was just too much one-lane racing. And I was never accustomed to that. Maybe that's how Grandview is, you know what I mean? Right. You know, fighting for the bottom and stuff like that, but I was just not accustomed to it, so I definitely like having the two groove. You know, I would prefer a good bottom lane, a good top lane, and slick through the middle. I think that would be, you know, the ideal driver track.
Okay. Did you ever have the course during the season to decide if you wanted to start on the inside or the outside on the front row?
Heat races, that's for sure.
And which one did you prefer, basically?
I mean, I picked the bottom, I think, a lot this year, for sure. Just it's weird because Grandview, once again, is different because you start at the very, very, very end of the backstretch.
Right.
So you're starting right into a turn, and mm-hmm. you're not already in the turn, or you're not already on the front stretch like other racetracks do. So it's different there. So I just decide, okay, I'm not gonna. If somebody's gonna pass me on the top.
How do you like the guardrails at Grandview? They're not in every corner. They kind of sneak up on you through.
They're better than Uke tires.
Yeah.
For sure.
But I mean, you go to a place like Lincoln, they have it all the way around.
Yeah,
you
know? that was different. I got to run Lincoln in the little car, and that was different running around a track when you run the bottom and it's just a guardrail all the way around. Mm-hmm. Because most of the time, where you can't see is that those guardrails are probably not straight.
Oh, yeah. The backstretch wall,
it actually bows out, doesn't it?
They said they actually changed it a little bit this year, made it straighter. Well, you would know from years past, really, I guess, would you?
Right.
Used to come off a 2 and it would kind of have a bend in it.
It still has a little bit of a wiggle, but I don't think it's that mm-hmm. big of a deal now.
Now, do you actually prefer a dry track or a wet track? I mean, they say everybody can drive a wet track. It takes the real driver to figure out the dry one. But
yeah, I like dry tracks. I think it's, as a driver, it's giving you more options, and it's making it, you know, a lot of fun. I mean, you just hit the nail on the head saying if the track's too wet, you're just going to be out there hammering the gas and, you know, following people and stuff like that. It makes it fun when it's slick.
Okay, when you're out running the feature and you're starting maybe fourth, fifth, somewhere around there, do you actually want to follow the driver going into the turn, or do you have a vision of, you know, possibly moving your groove out and passing him? When you get to the first turn after on a restart, or actually on a start itself, what part of that front straightaway do you realize that you're actually going to take the bottom or the top?
I would say flag stand area. I mean, you're definitely basing on, if it's the initial start, I always try and give myself a little bit of extra room, right, just in case, you know what I mean, because nobody's going to win on the first lap. So I think by the flag stand, you'll kind of know what the people are doing in front of you, whether, you know, if say the leader spun his tires or something, you're starting sixth, well, obviously you're going to stick to the top, right, you know. So it kind of depends on what the guys are going to do in front of you, but it's the rule of thumb, you know, go where they're not. So
okay, now during the course of the off season, there's a lot of these indoor shows. You have Motorsports, you have the Reading show, you have the Phillipsburg show. You go to these mall shows or the indoor shows to check out the competition and see what they got lined up for the year, or you just go to enjoy yourself and be with the fans?
Yeah, I just go to enjoy myself and look at cars, kind of gets you into the season mode and kind of thing, you know what I mean? But I don't go check out competition or anything like that. I mean, just see people's paint jobs, or I might notice if somebody changes chassis brands or something like that, but I'm not gonna like go underneath their cars and all that crazy stuff.
Okay, so. You've been in the Sportsman for 2 years now. Can you see, is there a real big change or a overall change, you know, with the TOs, with the Big Nels, with the Troyers, with the Higfabs? Is there a big variance in the chassis themselves, or just a bar or two moved here and there?
For the most part, they're basically the same from what I'm doing. I mean, I've been doing a lot of research in the last couple of weeks, actually, and there's some parts that you can bolt on, you know what I mean? TOs and Bicknells, there's some stuff you can bolt on, but other stuff you can't,
right.
Vice versa. But there's definitely some things lately now that I think things are really picking up on that end, that they're getting, you know, real far out of the box, we'll say. And I think most of the people are keeping, you know, TO's trying to keep their information with them, and Bicknell's trying to, you know what I mean? It's it's starting to get almost to the NASCAR end of things for sure. Cause,
well, they said like the Bicknell cars are easier to maintain, mainly because if you need a part, you can call up Pete or whoever, Randy up there.
Yeah.
Say I need an A47 bar or whatever.
Right.
And it comes to you, and then you just bolt it right in there and it fits, and they're all basically, you know, interchangeable.
Yeah, and then the TO people will say, well, that's just, you know, assembly line stuff. Like, we like the TO stuff because it's cut threads, new cutting edge stuff and stuff like that.
Right.
But then the Bicknell people will say, well, you know, how do you know it's going to work? And,
right.
You know, yada, yada. So it's kind of, that's all stuff I'm learning too, trust me. It's a lot to learn.
Okay, what kind of shocks you got in a 16, Ryan?
I have just regular steel Bilstein shocks. Just nothing.
All four corners?
All four corners.
No, are they adjustable?
No
shocks?
No.
Coilovers?
Nope, yep, just regular coilovers. Not all, coilovers in the front, obviously, torsion bars.
Torsion
bars
in the rear.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not trying the four coil stuff. People want me to, but I don't know about that yet. But just plain old Jane steel, you know, steel shocks. I had Rick Laubach do them for me. But
now, what's the plan for 2017? You take the same car and basically just go over everything, clean it up good.
2017's a little up in the air right now for me, actually, just because obviously blowing the motor up was a big hurt for me, but. You know, I got some sponsors behind me, but obviously we're looking, you know, I'm looking to upgrade my program for sure. I think, you know, shocks and chassis, it's something I really would like to, you know, try and do, actually. Because I think we had a good piece, but I think I can do a lot better with some better stuff. So,
flea market shopper?
Yeah, definitely. Why not? You know, why not? It's just only 2 years. I don't have everything in the garage, so... So you never know what you can find, and you know, you never know what you can sell either. You know, I might have something somebody needs.
Okay, now the indoor season will be coming up. The Dover race, I mean the Trenton race, the Allentown race, the Atlantic City race. Do you ever go see any of those indoor races?
Yeah, I went to Allentown last year, actually.
Part of the overflow crowd that was there?
I was part of it.
He wants you to get him a slingshot ride, by the way.
that's actually the question.
Oh, okay.
If you were offered a ride, the idea of driving in an indoor racetrack like that, would that come to excite you?
Yeah, I'd love to try it. I don't know about a TQ. I mean, sure, I wouldn't turn it down, but I don't know. I mean, I'm confident, but those are crazy cars. So Slingshot would be fun. I think I'd have no problem trying that. It's almost like a big S&S, really.
Now... With that, I mean, for anybody that goes to the indoor races, it's come a long way from the older days of the indoor circuit and the midgets. They have a specialty chassis now, the Lafler chassis, and then Buckwalter has that big, long number 8 that he was driving, and these guys build their homemade cars. Can you see the time where the Sportsman racing or modified racing in general just goes back to... you know, any kind of homemade chassis that they used to run in the 60s and the 70s?
I would hope so. But the way that the technology is coming into the sport now, I don't think it's going to happen anytime soon. Right now, just the technology with these big teams now having chassis dynos and having wind tunnel time and stuff like that, I mean, it's getting to the point now. I think the technology end of it is coming into play. So maybe once that... you know, fizzles out and there's still people around, maybe it'll come back to that. But I think right now it's just the technology is going to take over.
Okay. My wife had a question I have to ask her. And this is actually pretty good. I sort of enjoyed it when I was reading it. if Sportsman and modified race teams were allowed to have spotters, would you want your spotter to constantly talk to you or only get on there when needed?
Only when needed. Only when needed. I wouldn't want any other. My dad always says I'm a different person when I put my helmet on. So like when I have my helmet on, it's kind of like my own piece, and I'd like to have, you know, it's my ship kind of thing. So
would they be more of a distraction than your ear all the time?
Yeah. I mean, not really. I wouldn't be too distracted. I'd probably tell them, you know, to be quiet in a more foul way. But
okay, now with that, does the driver in car that they have at Grandview, does that actually help you guys in moments where, you know, a caution comes out, knowing where you have to, you know, slow down? Is that an actual big help for you?
Yes.
And can you hear that during the whole course of the race with the engines going, or is it one of them deals where it actually is more, it sounds better when the yellow's out?
It always sounds better when the yellow's out, but definitely if you spend the money to get yourself some good earplugs, you know, they make the molded ones and stuff like that, it's good because it saves your hearing in a way. And it also, yeah, you can hear pretty good. I like it. I think it helps the fans. It helps them organize the show, you know, people fighting for spots and stuff like that. I think it's definitely better.
Well, how about Grandview now with the handicapping, the payoff, just the way the rules and things are? Are you happy with things there, or do you think they need to tweak it a little bit maybe?
No, I was happy with it.
So
they make the handicap, and that's tough. I mean it is super, super tough there with their handicap. And I mean, if the closer you get in points, the further back you're starting in heat races. And you know, with where I was all year being from like 12th to 20th in points, mm-hmm. I knew no matter what that everybody behind me was ready to go. Right. You know, I had, you know, the Hens and Lazowski's and Arnold's and Whitmore's and all them. I knew that they were coming. So it's just one of them things where you got to get moving.
Okay. Are you social media conscious, Ryan?
I am. I'm not big into it, but I mean, I'm on it every day kind of thing, because there's just too much stuff to read anymore. I mean, there's just good articles and movies and videos and all that other stuff. So
do you have any kind of websites or anything on Facebook or Twitter or anything? A lot of these fans, they'd like to jump on there.
No, I mean, I'm on there. Just my name, nothing. I don't have any websites or anything like that, but I'm on Twitter and Facebook. So
you have your own merchandise?
I don't. A couple of my sponsors, I have some t-shirts, but they're old kind of way. So I have a couple hats too that my sponsor hooked me up with, but not too many. But I think next year, if we have a good off season and can attract some people, I'm definitely getting some t-shirts, that's for sure. So I will have them next year.
Okay. Are you fan available after the races are over?
Every night, always.
Okay.
Providing that I roll the car onto the trail.
Okay, here's the proverbial question that we like to ask. Who washes the car on a Sunday?
Oh, that would be me and my father. Normally my father is already there, you know, in the staging area. He don't mind pressure washing the car, but I'm definitely scrubbing the body. There's no doubt about that.
Away from the racetrack, do you follow any other types of classes or any drivers?
I'm a huge fan of wingless sprint cars, USAC sprint cars. I mean, I will not miss the Eastern Storm. I go every year. I try to go to Kokomo every year, or anywhere in Indiana I do. I mean, I go to races all the time. If I'm not racing, I'll be at the racetrack pretty much.
So you're not one of those that goes to the track and wishes you had a race car and goes crazy watching. You actually are a fan.
Nope. Yeah, definitely the wingless cars. I'll sit there and I'll holler and scream and lose my voice because I really enjoy watching them things and watching them guys drive.
Okay, other than your father and your grandfather, who was your boyhood idol when you were growing up watching the race?
Probably Billy Pouch. I was a big fan of the Zemco sprint car, whether it be Bobby Weaver was in it for a little bit, yeah, or Billy Pouch. I mean, that was my car pretty much growing up. I had, I don't know how many Billy Pouch Zemco t-shirts that he signed, and I used to yell at mom for washing them because the ink would come out and you know, all that stuff. So I would probably say that.
Did you ever get to Flemington when it was dirt?
No. Nope, only asphalt.
Oh, only asphalt. Okay.
Yep, I didn't make it there when it was dirt.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, so on a normal night at Grandview, what are your basic costs for the evening? What's the cost for fuel for the evening, Ryan?
Well, let's see. It would be rather 50. I mean, you're looking at about 100, 100 and a quarter, something like that, I would say.
Okay, do you start the night with the tank full, or you want the tank sort of empty so you don't have that much weight to lug around?
Something I'm learning. I mean, it means a lot. I mean, you talk to, you know, I'll call Randy at Bicknell, and, you know, they're big on, you know, make sure that fuel tank ends with 4 inches of fuel in the bottom of it. So I try to do that, and I also try to get in a rhythm where I'm not dumping, you know, 10 gallons in every night, and just trying to get in a rhythm there, and we did. We actually had a good system going there with fuel that I wasn't burning so much fuel every night, but all it took was one consi, and that ruined that. So
well, I know a lot of times the features, some nights you just go right through, everything's great. Mm-hmm. Then some nights you get those real stinkers where you get yellow after yellow after yellow, and it just drives you nuts because you're just, you know, it takes you 50 minutes to run a 25-lap race. Those nights just must drive you crazy out there.
Yeah. Yeah, more or less, because those nights happen not just in our class. They'll happen in every class.
Oh, yeah.
So then you're sitting there just in the staging area waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. And so.
Okay, we're coming down to the one-minute mark, but I have to ask you this. Is there a way, and I know you had trouble, or not trouble, but you dealt with it at Grandview this year, is there a way to keep the lap cars from changing the outcome of a race?
I don't know about that. I mean, that's up to the driver's discretion and listening to the flagman, you know, and I think most flagmen will preach hold your line.
Yeah.
I think that's majorly, you know, the answer to that. So as long as they hold their line. But a lot of times with Grandview, at that point when you are catching lap traffic, everybody knows what lane's faster. Yeah. So as long as they're putting lap cars to the rear and don't put them in between.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I think that, I totally disagree with that, but as long as they put them to the rear, I think.
They always say they're fighting for a spot too, which really to them might be something, but to the actual payoff, it's not a lot.
Okay, with 30 seconds left to go, 2017 plans, if all goes well, another year at Grandview?
Absolutely. Oh. Yep, that would definitely be my plans for sure. So like I said, just got to rebuild the motor. Looking for a new chassis, for sure. I want to upgrade my chassis, and you know, if the right people come along, you know, shocks and stuff like that too. But we got to take it one day at a time, for sure.
Okay, so our 12th anniversary show featured Ryan Higgs, sportsman driver at Grandview. So on behalf of Randy Kane, Ryan Higgs, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.
Hi, my name is Joe Vaccaro Jr., driver of the Mary's Six Pack and More sponsored number 53 Speedster.
And my name is Joey Vaccaro, driver of the Mary's Six Pack and More sponsored number 53 Slingshot.
After a long day of work, working at home, or as for us, working on your race cars, there's no better place to stop by than Mary's Six Pack and More for all your adult beverage needs. Mary's Six Pack has over 3,000 different beers in stock and offers a 20% discount on mixed six packs. Mary's also has 14 different beers on tap and offers complete growler service for your fresh beer needs. Also come in on Sundays for some bench racing with thy bartender, Diane Tobias.
Once again, for all your adult beverage needs, come to Mary's Six Pack and More, 835 Easter Lanes, Reading, PA.